Hi, today we're going to talk about a concept my students and I call the wrist pop elbow drop. In this video, I will be covering the wrist pop, what it is, things that could be inhibiting it, the elbow drop, what it is, things that could be inhibiting it, and at the end, I will talk about a few quick exercises that you or your students can use to help this technique along. So, the first thing, the wrist pop, is when our wrist comes up. We start with a bow in the middle, and the wrist should come up. You can't see because I'm seated, but my wrist is relatively flat in the middle of the bow. And then as the bow comes up, my wrist also comes up. Things that could be inhibiting the wrist pop, you really want to check your bow hand and make sure that it's resting between the first and second knuckles of your index finger, between here. If the bow is resting here, then you're going to have limited wrist mobility. You also want to check your starting bow angle. One of the reasons we wrist pop to begin with is to keep the bow parallel to the bridge. If my bow is crooked, that kind of defeats the purpose of the wrist pop, because I start crooked and I'm just going to end up even more crooked. So make sure you start your up bow parallel to the bridge, and then the wrist pop will also keep it parallel as you approach the frog. Now, the third thing that could be inhibiting your wrist pop is if you're not willing to go side of hair as you approach the frog. It's possible to keep the bow straight, parallel to the bridge, and to stay with relatively flat hair. And indeed, sometimes we want to do this if we want a more strong sound. But I find when we're starting out with the wrist pop, it's nice for me to just let the bow fall away like that. And that's going to make the wrist want to pop up a little bit easier. Also, as a side note, you want to make sure that the bow is kind of an extension of the bow arm. Sometimes when we think too hard about a bow hold and a placement for each finger, our bow hand becomes kind of wooden, and that locks up the wrist and we're not able to go to the lower half as we want to. So I recommend, if you're having trouble with the wrist pop, you even just drop the bow, pick up a pencil, and do some nice bow hand exercises to strengthen each of those fingers. There are even some devices that rock climbers use to help with grip strength and also finger mobility. So that's what we're really looking for when we hold the bow. We also want a very flexible pinky, one that's willing to stay slightly curved, because the pinky is in a curved position as we go to the frog. So those are all kind of extra side notes. Now, going into the elbow drop, as we go to the frog, the elbow likes to drop. That first one was maybe a little bit too low. It is possible to drop the elbow too low and too high. We'll talk about that later. But one of the problems that happens with the elbow drop is we shrug the right shoulder. We think that because we're going up bow, the wrist is coming up, we might want to shrug that right shoulder. That's a problem many of my teachers tried to beat out of me with no avail. Well, I think I've corrected it somewhat by now, but so we don't want to shrug the right shoulder. Have someone lightly press on your right shoulder as you play to help you relax. Right? They can touch your shoulder when you start to press. It'll just remind you to drop it. Lifting your elbow too high can also inhibit the elbow drop. Right? I mean, that's kind of duh. Yeah, you're supposed to be dropping your elbow, and if you raise it, you're not. But oftentimes we think because my wrist is coming up, so should my elbow. You'll probably end up playing on the stick of your hair, or on the stick of your bow if you do that. Third thing, dropping your elbow too low can also be a problem. So correct elbow heights are gonna vary from string to string, but of course, if I'm on the A string here, I wanna think about there being just a little bit of cushion between my side and my arm. I'm not down here. I call this playing like a T-Rex, and I'm not way up here. I call that playing like a chicken. We don't want chickens or T-Rexes. Those three things should help with your elbow drop. And we need to do the elbow drop really, because as you approach the lower half, it's just gonna help give you a nice relaxed sound. Again, there might be some instances where you don't want to drop the elbow as much, or maybe you even lift it intentionally, but I think as a starting point to get us with a nice relaxed sound. So as a side, if you're playing in the upper half of the bow, you're gonna use more of an elbow forearm stroke, right? I find a problem with playing in the lower half, achieving that wrist pop elbow drop, is that we don't transition our brain from playing with a forearm stroke to really using the shoulder. I think as teachers, we can overemphasize the forearm stroke so much so that students lock up their shoulder. We really do need that to be nice and loose and mobile so that the shoulder and upper arm can really help finish the stroke. All right, now last thing, exercises to help with playing at the frog, wrist pop, elbow drop, etc. Rocket bows. So rocket bows are what I have my students do when we're practicing like the beginning of Hunter's course. We do rocket bows because there's lots of springy up bows that go really, really fast. So a rocket bow is where, yes, we play with tremendous bow speed. We think of going past the frog on an up bow. Because I find if we don't think about going past the frog, then students typically will want to stop somewhere in here. This is like the no play zone. We don't rosin it. We don't use it. The other day a student was like, why is my bow slippery? I'm like, because you don't rosin your bow right there. Add some rosin and it'll be a lot better. And furthermore, use that part of your bow. It's really, really helpful. We just don't know how. So think of going past the bow with much more bow speed. And then also really think about that wrist pop. Sometimes it's easier to do that wrist pop when your bow isn't on the string, so I'm actually coming off the string too. You could also practice landing again. Okay. Also, if you're just practicing down bows, if you don't want to practice up bows, sometimes it's helpful to do a fake up bow before you begin the down bow. Again, you're going past and then landing. This will help you get all the way to the frog, start at the frog, go to the frog, etc., etc. Last thing is, I've tried practicing sometimes with a bow hold further up the stick. I'm not exactly sure where I need to place it, but we'll experiment here. I'm going to start in the middle. Maybe that was a little too high. Let's try the silver winding. This will give us an exaggerated wrist pop. It's hard to do. I should probably practice it. My fingers keep getting in the way and hitting the string, but that is also an idea to help you with the wrist pop elbow drop. So I have some notes helped me make this video. I'll post them in the comments of this video so you can access these tips as much as you like, and so you don't have to keep rewinding the video because it's pretty long. All right, have a nice day. I hope these tips were helpful. Bye.